video.
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
Hi, Samin, hi.
All right.
Dr. Kinney, hi. You're up live?
Yes.
We can hear you. We can see you.
All right, and we can hear you very well.
Perfect. The floor is yours.
Yes. And let's start with the, while engaging, maybe I can quickly present the case. While Dr. Kinney is engaging, if we can show that slides very quickly. This patient is an 86-year-old female who presented last year during Thanksgiving to outside hospital with small bowel obstruction. She did have a lot of comorbid conditions before, but at that time developed non-STEMI and has acute systolic heart failure. The cardiac cath done outside after stabilization, she got diuretic, antibiotics, and so on and so forth, and cath revealed three vessel and left main disease with high syntax score of 42 and EF was 32%. So patient was referred for CABG, but after heart team discussion, was felt to be high risk for CABG, largely because of comorbidities and high STS. And she does have a moderate COPD, and STS risk mortality was 6.2. And at that time, this was all outside, was suggested, patient continued maximum medical therapy. So she did good. She has those risk of the hyperlipidemia, hypertension, prior CVA, but she ambulates, has a PAD and COPD with the moderate COPD, FEV1 is about 62%, AFib, and she's on good medical therapy. So on medical therapy, she has done very well and came to see me about a week ago because of increasing symptoms. Next slide. Now this is the angiogram which we are going to show you. Are you ready to take a picture?
One second.
Your caudal, you did or no?
I did.
Okay, show from the beginning. The creatinine is about borderline 1.8 for her, but this is the tight disease of the distal RCA, but more so of the PDA.
So but 80-90% PDA.
But we are not showing this case for this purpose. Look at the calcium of the distal left main, LAD, and this. The truly the diseases from the distal left main to LAD, so it will be a 110. If we call CERC actually as a side branch, although CERC is equal size, and additional lesion in the LAD and additional lesion in the branches of the circumflex, both OM2 as well as LPL. So that's where we case with that ejection fraction. If we can go back to the slide over quickly, patient next. So. Next, so patient there was in good medical therapy, and because of when consulted me, I said this is the right case for the protected PCI, and this is the next, and patient we brought for this purpose. I was guided PCI of the left main circ LAD using rotational atherectomy because of calcification, and LV assist using Impella with the LV dysfunction, which is exactly for this purpose. Next. And only one slide. Next, I want to show, of course, PCI CABG versus. The key is that if you go by the guidelines, it may be inappropriate, but we also know after the heart team discussion, it is appropriate to do these cases because this case, otherwise viable, has had a heart team discussion. Next. And so that I call it appropriate, maybe rightly or wrongly, but patient had a here now, after discussion, to be taken care of this left main and LAD and, of course, the RCA. So with that note, we can have some discussion while we are getting ready things. We already have, as you see, Impella has been inserted, and Dr. Kinney is now putting up the rotor wire because of that extensive calcification. Knowing it's a very large vessel, it probably will require the additional, in addition to rotor, probably some kind of atherotomy technique to open the lesion valve.
Okay, so Samin. Great case, very complex. Definitely most of us would agree with the support. There's no doubt about that. So a couple of questions. First, it's nice to see that the guidelines can change by the ultimate decree of the heart team. That's a good thing. I'm going to take it back to California and tell them that. But besides this, do you think that you need any imaging? You're going to do imaging first?
I think we can do. We actually have planned for. I was ready, right? Yeah, I was ready. So you want to put a wire into the other view?
No, I'm trying to see if I can wire and we can get.
Yeah, this is the kind of case again that you can think about that may not that get a, our we need to do IVUS anyway.
You can do IVUS on this one.
I was on the rotavire.
Marish, I was on the rotavire. Usually, is a little bit difficult.
Is there any idea where the myocardial infarction is, or the other way around, where the ischemia is?
Yeah, anterior one. So no, the patient did not have any functional study, but they on the echo, there is a moderate to severe hypo of the anterior wall, moderate of the inferior wall, and apical severe hypokinesis with little thinning. So clearly, the patient had a LAD MI at that time.
And the other thing is, I fully do agree with the Impella approach. The thing is that we, luckily enough, have the 4.0, which has much better results than the 2.5 liters. And I don't know, I think this is a 2.5 or a 4.0.
Yeah, probably, it's 2.5 probably. But also, remember, she's 86 with vascular disease. Yeah. And you're not doing it as a hemodynamic for heart failure. I think it's, I personally believe it's appropriate and enough.
I do agree.
Knows what we need.
Yeah.
But go ahead.
So us also the same, because unless patient is in kind of pre-shock condition or severe or hemodynamically instability, her pressure is good, 140 or 70. We also did a right heart cath, which was normal. Now, actually very interesting. This is the one patient who had PA pressure of 60 over 30 back then in November. She was requiring BiPAP and so now actually right heart pressures were normal with a wedge pressure of 14. So with that, we felt that it will be reasonable to just use a 2.5. We between 2.5 and 4 CP, our distribution actually is about 60% 2.5 and 40% CP.
So what wire do you have now?
I have a fine cross with a run-through wire trying to get into the LAD.
Okay. So the idea would be to, once you get into the LED, do this a little bit of the IVUS, and then decide how much and where to do, how much calcification there is, etc. It's not, the IVUS here is not diagnostic to tell us that there is calcium. I don't think that that's the case. So some people may say, why would you do it? It makes no sense.
That was me.
So that's why I'm reading the mind of David Cox here, and so David, what's your problem?
No, I'm just we're going to do rotational atherectomy, and that's going to debulk it.
I'll be the devil's advocate for a second as they're working. So you'll do it, and you will not see circumferential. You'll see two or three arcs, but heavily calcified, a lot of kind of shadowing. But I will use a cutting balloon. That's enough. It's the modern-day rotational atherectomy tool.
First of all, I don't think it is, and I like rotational atherectomy. Present company doesn't make me feel that way. I think it's a great tool for this case. And I just, whether or not you want to IVUS it afterwards, you do it. But I would run my burr and get a nice result now.
So if you look at now, everybody that is new, has come, call them the younger people.
Yeah.
I can guarantee you that rotational atherectomy will come forth in their idea about where this.
And that just shows how hard it is to wire these lesions sometimes, too. So you just got to be patient. She did a great job. And, you know, I just don't think they have to do sequential cutting balloons, up, down, up, down.
Back that's what they
forth.
Would do, yeah.
I don't know.
Fayez, what you're thinking?
Oh, well, you know, I agree with what has been done so far because of the low EF rotational atherectomy, you need some kind of support. I think you went in the right direction to the rotational atherectomy.
Yeah, I think with the
1.5 to the LAD and 2.0 to the left main.
Okay, so the key is
we're just discussing the burr size.
So basically, what we are planning is that we have crossed with the rotavire and the fielder fine cross, actually run through. We changed it, and this one was very difficult, even the fine cross go through the mid lesion. So our plan is not to do IVUS at this time, because IVUS may not go and unnecessarily will prolong the procedure. That do the rota first, and then plan will be 1.5 for the mid LAD and 2.0 for the proximal, and then we decide IVUS before or after PTCA. And if that's okay, we are ready for a 1.5 bar at present while you are having a discussion.
So I think that's a great plan. Many people who, again, are not very familiar or as experienced as you are in the rotational arthrectomy would kind of go with a 1.25. This is a waste of time.
Yeah.
And the question is how much bigger than 2.0 you should do for the left main. And that means you need a different guiding catheter in terms of size. So I think the choice of 1.5-2.0 is good for what we are trying to accomplish, which is plaque modification.
That's correct. So the key is that people talk about debulking. I say we do not debulk the lesion nowadays. We just modify.
Yeah, it's plaque modification in order to give you stent expansion. Now, the sad part of this is that no matter how good the debulking agent is, or at least the modifier is, if we don't take plaque volume mass, we are not going to be able to show that in addition to stenting, this will give us any more long-term durability. We've spent 2 decades, you, myself, and others, to show that.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, that's not the aim. The aim is to make the procedure easier on the patient and on the operator and safer for both of those parties.
Absolutely. Okay, so this is ready with the 1.5.
Yeah, I absolutely, totally agree. One of the things is that why is rote ablation not so popular? That is because it is still...
It's harder
to use, and a lot of people say.
Yeah, I think I have the answer to that one. We had many focus groups now with younger generation. First of all, they're not exposed to it. They don't. So if you do one every 2 months or 3 months, you're not facile enough. The device is associated, if you don't do it right, with a little bit more complications.
That's correct.
And that's the fear.
Okay. But I have teach my fellows extensively in it, and I see every week that they are using it now.
They are.
So in my opinion, for heavy calcified lesions, it is still the best solution.
Yeah, I think so too. But I'm not going to get into the CSI versus what story of yesterday. I'm going to leave it alone.
Yeah. So, but I think the point is well taken. Particularly, it will get a nice second wind once the BRS starts being used, whether it's a BVS or newer generation. So clearly, that will be the factor. So we usually do at a low speed of 150,000 RPM. We are ready. The tension has been taken out by the advancer knob.
Yeah. We're just going to show the 3 steps that before you start rota, very important that you move the black knob backward forward, the tension between the Teflon sheet and the bar is removed. You open the Y connector, fluoro.
Yep.
Move the bar backward forward. Any tension between the wire and the bar is removed. And the last will be that you do a Dynaglot tap and you see the bar did not move. Even if it had moved, it will be just at the RPM of 65 to 70,000, which will be slower. So we know there's disease in the left main, calcium in the left main. So we are just coming out of the guide and start burring right at the ostium of the left main to distal left main.
And we know the left main, it will go pecking, very easy. Yeah.
Slow pecking motion, backward, forward, not a lot.
No.
And this is the patient, this is a temporary pacer or a permanent pacer? I didn't see. This is a temporary pacer, right?
Yeah, temporary. You know, many of, because she originally in November, when she had a cath, she apparently developed heart blocks. So that's why the question is whether it's RCA was culprit with that PDA.
Yeah.
But she never required permanent pacemaker. I mean, it's a dramatic compared to the notes I got from the hospital when I saw the patient in the office versus I saw clearly. So I think that's why in many of the complex left main, we do leave the temporary pacemaker. We know that the use of the temporary pacemaker will be, it will fire probably in less than 10% of cases.
Yeah.
So every burst is every time 20 seconds, we just stop it, slow pecking motion again, same, go backward, forward, come back, a little bit forward.
Yeah. That's a very good technique. And the origin of this technique, for those who don't do it too much, and the understanding is that with the increased RPM, and if you have a lot of hanging or you go for very long in place of very long passages, there is heat that develops inside the artery, and that we think is the genesis of the spasm and much of the slow flow or no reflow.
Yeah.
So the shorter the runs, the more slow and very pondered approach it is, the less no reflow you will get.
And see that 1.5 giving us so much difficulty in the mid segment.
Yeah. But I say just be patient with it and not downsize unless you have to.
Yeah.
And she's getting lifted.
Good.
That's it.
Good.
Slow and, you know, it's just you have to lean on it.
Policy.
And keep going with it.
Good.
Preventing Good. The jumping and then doing these polishing runs that she's doing back and forth to show
no
friction with any plaque. You see smoothness of the passageway.
Go.
I'm not sure the IBIS would have gone down if the 1.5 was
probably
so
not, yeah. But I was trying to be academic.
I understand.
No.
I didn't ask for an FFR, so you don't feel
that. I'm very happy with that. Very happy.
So again, do you guys put anything in the rotor flush? Do
yeah,
you put
same.
Anything?
We're still on the same side. Actually, we had a just discussion a few days ago. Should we change our approach? We actually have been doing the same 5 milligram nitro, 5 verapamil, and 5,000 heparin in a 500 ml bag. So,
yeah.
Question is, a lot of people believe that verapamil is not a good drug. Now, the nicardipine is apparently available and better drug. We have not tried it. But
you
that's what we will start doing it now.
Yep.
But
Maurice, do you use Rotoglide when you do Rotoglide?
Rotoglide in every case, yeah.
Definitely Rotoglide in everything. It helps a great deal with decreasing the temperature and the friction. That we can see on the bench, and all our studies have shown that with platelet aggregation. But in terms of the vasodilators and vasoactive agents, F has been, you know, plus minus, depending on the nurse. If the nurse is going to take too long, it's no. If not, it's yes.
I think I'm here to keep you from getting into trouble if I got to come up with something. He didn't mean it.
So now you're going to go with the 2-0?
They're going up with the 2-0, yes.
And I think that probably just to the proximal segment. I mean, although the LED looks quite good now, whether if everything looks good, do we go to the second part? Probably not. So we go to the now for the left main. They want to make sure that we cover from the ostium. We got a diffuse left main. And really there is a chunk of calcium at the ostium. And hopefully they will see that on the IVUS. Good.
This is
same 150 outside.
That Dr. Sharma mentioned.
Yeah.
In the olden days, we would foolishly go with the 2-0 burr into the mid-LED where there's all these angulated segments. But at the end of the day, the risk probably was greater than the potential benefit, and we have shied away from it. So I totally support your thinking that maybe there is no need.
Yeah.
If, on the other hand, the balloon that you put in is continuously deformed and is undilatable, that's why I dilate over the rotor wire already. If that is not, I have no hesitation to take the balloon and upsize by one, like a 1.75. So in the past, we used to change the wire to a regular wire immediately after the completion, and now I keep the rotor wire, do my post-dilatation. If it is still impacting the lesion, I go up with one side.
Plus, you know, even if you do the balloon, but you have still indentation, you're still safer to upside the bar, because there's always this notion, hey, I just use a balloon, I don't want to rotate.
Yeah.
Exactly. I think so long you have still indentation, it is pretty safe to upside the bar.
Yep.
No, actually, very nice suggestion by Maurice is that let's do a balloon dilatation on this. Or maybe I think if for interest point of view, why don't we do the IVUS first? Do we do IVUS now or after balloon?
After balloon.
Okay.
Why struggle over that wire?
Let's get a 3-0. Yep.
So let, give me the run through wire.
You know, if that 1-5 burr wouldn't go, I bet you a cutting balloon would have had trouble getting to that illusion.
But this is the whole thing as we started this discussion. Why do the IVUS? It's an obvious rotoblader case. Well, that's because you're an expert at it. But think and put yourself in the other side of the fence where not many, many people would start with balloon, cutting balloon, dissection, another balloon, parallel wire, and all that scenario. And that is what has led to so-called roto regret, right? That's the problem.
Okay. Plus, you know, by doing the roto of that distal left main and osteoid, you're going to have a less flag shift into the circumflex.
Good point. Yeah, excellent point.
Go.
And you see how hemodynamically stable the patient is. Yeah. That takes a great deal of burden off your shoulder of the operators. It's a difficult case. So this is a perfect example where an impella supported will allow you to do as much as you can and as much as you should.
Yeah, and that's the key. I mean, people say, can you do it without it? Yeah, I say we can do it. But then sometimes we may too haste it. Patient will develop a slow flow and so forth. So look at this now. At 10 atmosphere, 3-0 balloon has fully expanded. And it being done on the rotavir.
That proves to you that you don't need at this point to go with a 1.75 or 2.0.
That's it.
There.
Yep.
In the olden days, we didn't know that. We went foolishly with a 1.75, 2.0 and got a perforation.
Yeah.
And we got in trouble.
Yeah.
And this is an important point. You see that we are dilating the left main osteo LAD, but make sure your guide is outside.
So far, it's pretty textbook. That's great. So hopefully the result will be exactly like that.
Okay, you want to drive us now?
Yeah.
Hey, Sameen, this is Fayaz Shaw. When do you decide, how are you? I'll be seeing you next 2 days in Mumbai, I guess. The question to you is, when do you decide between rotational atherectomy and orbital? When do you make a decision?
Yeah, I think in this particular case, one thing against orbital will be actually, and I really thank Dr. Ron Waxman in terms of giving us the chance and show the technique. And last TCT also to Dr. Leon to ask us to do both rota and orbital. So I think both technique, the point I made yesterday there, is that you need to become good at whatever you want. But in this particular case, because there is a osteo left main disease, so in the aorto osteal, there will be an issue with the orbital atherectomy. So that will be little no-no from orbit point of view. But rest of the case, distal left main, and LAD, you can easily use the orbital atherectomy. Now, other cases will be anytime you have unexpanded stent, your balloon did not crack. Those cases, I would say, will be the cases for rotational atherectomy. We don't have much experience in an unexpanded balloon. A lesion did not open up with the balloon, and should you do an orbital in those cases. But biggest advantage of the orbital is less slow flow, and just one burr can give you a very good lumen. And it really cut very deeply. We have published that, and we are doing many other studies to show the OCT mechanism between two of them. And clearly, the OCT has shown that orbital atherectomy really cuts the plaque into the calcium into the deep area, and we call it a gutter. And your stent really expands. So what is happening? It's not moving.
Okay,
it's not moving. No, we can start now. Okay, now we are ready. You want to flush a little bit?
No, you're good, you see.
So we'll look at the mid-LAD where most of the effective atherectomy was, and you will see a classical snowman, that snowman effect we should see within the calcium and separation of the calcium, right there. At 11 o'clock, 1 o'clock, you could see it. 1 second, we got a glimpse of it.
Yes.
Similar to the case that was shown yesterday in the Washington Hospital Center. I think that you don't see with the orbital atherectomy.
And now this is almost circular calcium there.
At one point you saw this right there, you see the kind of invagination of the calcium. That's more proximal LED, right?
Yeah,
this is a proximal austral LED. Now coming to the circumflex, and now distal left main.
So if you want to replay it back from the distal or the mid LED, and we can stop and pause it, I bet we can see a frame that demonstrates what I'm talking about, which is this eccentric bite out of the circumferential calcium.
Yeah, let's run through the fielder,
Here it comes.
So this all work was done on the rotor wire.
Yep. Right there. Stop it right there. Perfect. You see where at 1 o'clock, where you have the echo shadowing of the wire, you see the snowman effect. If you move it, for that is what I think was called the rotoblader signature. And that is perfect. And that's very hard to get with any other tool. Whether this is a must or not, I'll let you choose. But this is the signature.
But that really allows you to get a very good stent expansion.
Correct.
That's what we're doing here, to get a better stent expansion.
Yeah.
I mean, you can do a balloon, you know, but I think there's no question with that calcium. The rotoblader has a much more.
That outpouching is the thinning of the calcium, and that is where, because of the wire bias, that's where most of the activity happens, and you don't see that with any other orbital or other systems.
No question about that, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you think there's a critical osteo lesion or is non-critical of the circumflex?
What was the question, sorry?
Sameen, do you think the ostium has critical disease in the circumflex?
Yeah, well, that's a question we were just looking at it.
Graphically, it does not look
Yes.
So,
the caudal.
So we were just thinking maybe
stent across.
Stent across, yes.
I mean, for the long-term results, no.
Yeah.
Single stent strategy in this elderly patient may be more far more better than a two stent.
Right. Although in this particular case, we need to open some of the circumflex branches.
Yes.
Yeah.
Should you do the branches and then do maybe?
Then,
But the branches need some help.
Yeah, exactly.
Because in the IVIS, the ostium did not look so bad.
No, not the ostium, it's the distal.
The distal you had to do
the OMs.
Yeah.
One or two of the F. One of them is not much
LPL,
in the beginning,
LPL,
but this is, the second one seems to be larger and longer.
Yeah.
I would not go into a bifurcated CERC OM, complicated double kissing stance. I think this is keep it open approach.
Okay, you want to give me a balloon?
Yeah.
I think it's not going easy. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. So now we have the fielder wire, and we are going to use the same 3-0 balloon to open this LPL. An idea would be that we put a stent in the LPL after the PTCA, then we put stent in the mid LED, and then we stent across.
Precisely.
And make sure the IVUS is ready in the end again.
3-0 for this branch?
What stents are you going to choose?
Zines. 3023 or 28?
28.
3028 and 3.533.
Is that your workhorse stent?
Yes. So, I mean, we have equal of them. Zions and Promus both are, just two of them, with the our hospital with negotiation and so keep two of them. And this is the Zions and Promus and the Synergy.
What's your belief in the bioresorbable polymer versus non-bioresorbable?
Well, I think overall both looks quite good. So I would say that personally, I'm okay with great results with the Zions. So I think the Synergy, and so one of the big advantages of the Synergy is with the thin struts that really can go to a distal segment. And so in difficult cases. So let's got a new balloon, 2.5. No, 2.520 compliant balloon. Yeah. So this was a very angulated OM.
I find the emerge here gives you a particularly good advantage.
Okay, 2-0, 2-0, 20.
Yeah, it's like the lowest profile. What do you use, David?
Mostly an emerge, and I like to use Synergy a lot because I like this 3-month idea. I have a lot of elderly patients, and they don't seem to tolerate epidural or staff a long time.
Yeah, definitely the patients where their issue of the early surgery or issue about the long term, it will be a reasonable, those cases also sway us towards getting the synergy.
Even though we do not have any compelling data that speaks for that, but I think it makes sense. It's intuitively correct, and from the data of discontinuation, at least there is no signal that in those who discontinued early was a preponderance. So it's kind of like mitigated the pool of data. It's not prospectively studied for that, which is impossible to do, as we've learned.
And of course, the new trial will answer that question, but I think all, and we, you know, I current stent design, the unit of science, we have so many cases that we require surgery stopped at 3 months. Ready?
Yeah. Well, in Europe, I think Jacques and Hans can they have an indication for 3 months only with Zion.
Right.
Jos, what do you
go a little further?
Do you use Zion DS in three months, six months?
No, we did. At present, we're mostly using. We switched from Promise to Resolute Onyx and our Cyro as workhorse DES in our lab, with a small percentage of patients currently treated with BRS. But regarding the APT duration, we mostly stick to the 1 year.
So
also, given the increasing complexity of the procedures we're doing, like. I think this is a beautiful example.
So BRS is how much, you think, percentage?
In our practice, it was around 10%. I think we're now around 5 to 10%.
The used balloon 3020 would not make a turn in the circumflex. We took a 2012 new balloon. We dilated the LPL. Now we are going back with the 3020 high-pressure balloon to the LPL again.
Now, this is the case, because of the tortuosity of the proximal circ, the guideliner should be handy. No need to struggle and just put a stent if there is a difficulty just with the guideliner. But I think this balloon will tell us whether we need a guideliner or not.
If the balloon doesn't go or give you trouble, I think two options. Guideliner, like we said, but if you want to be quicker and more like, as I say, faster would be a buddy wire, and usually the buddy wires works all the time.
Yeah. You have seven French guys?
One more.
Or six?
Yeah, this is a seven French, yes.
Okay.
And even through six, you could do the buddy, no problem.
Yeah, but usually with the guideline, you run into trouble with two wires.
Yeah, I prefer the second wire approach. It's almost more quick and dirty and practical.
Cheaper. You know, in some cases, you might use a wiggle wire. If you have tortuosity and bias, we use a wiggle wire, especially to cross the stent near that.
Yeah, right here it's crossed, no problem whatsoever.
I'm happy to see you're proceeding quite well, since I have to admit, to be honest, this lady is 86, peripheral artery disease, COPD. You could have argued only to stick to treating the LAD and maybe the right, given it's a right dominant system.
No, but she's a young 86.
Okay.
A lot of those in New York City.
How do you do the guideline with the left main? With the LED?
It's a new lingo for the time. It's a young 92.
Stent is already down.
Okay.
I mean, otherwise, I don't know.
Okay. Let's see. Let's go with the balloon again.
It's looking like it's going to go. It has,
maybe just at the Austin.
Yeah, look at that. Yeah. It sort of hangs up there, doesn't it? Even after rotational.
Okay, just go. Little ostium. I think we need to just change the configuration of the ostium.
What are you worried about?
Good.
Osteal circ, sort of mid-LAD seems to hang up there.
I think it is the angle and the calcification there.
I think we need to put a second wire.
A hydrophilic body wire cannot cure on that one. Yeah. So the question here is, once you dilate it, are you forced to stent it or not?
Yeah. I think it looks how it looks. If it looks good,
I mean, in this case, in the end, knowing that we may have to go someday to that OM and other branches, what do you think?
It'll be okay.
And go up here?
Go up here. Okay.
Okay.
What's the stent length?
We have the guideline already. Okay, what is the stent we have for the LPL? 3 or 28, yeah. Yep. Yeah. Do you want to one put in the LED and take the wire out, or what do you want to do? Yeah.
Why do you prefer the guideliner, Sameer?
No, I think we put a second wire. We are ready to put our run-through wire into the circumflex. I think part of that has been
problem.
I usually put the wire anyways. Yeah, why sweat it? Yeah. It takes 2 seconds and that's it.
So we are putting a run-through. No, we are just keeping it ready on a standby, not opening yet. Not to increase the cost of the device of the cath lab. So here, we are putting a run-through into the circumflex now.
Okay.
As you suggested.
Yep. It's all to be cost conscious.
Yes.
Yeah, will you?
We can remove
you have
the
to be careful now. With two distal position of the wire, maybe.
Yeah.
You said this is the run through. What was?
Yeah, this is the run through.
Yeah.
Yeah, between three wires, you know, always a trouble. They get
twisted. I think just the guide positioning is it. Yeah, it's a little bit.
Yeah, you got a new one?
That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. The guy was a little bit hampering you. Now you're fine.
Sure. You need a...
Okay, wait.
Yep. Looking good.
Wire has taken a lot of beating.
that's
still
okay.
Still making it that.
It'll serve the purpose. As a matter of fact, you don't need to be that far deep. Right now, you're good enough because all what you're doing is for a standby glide.
Yeah.
So wherever it lands safely, that's okay.
Yeah.
Because your main wire is still in position.
Yeah.
There you have.
Good. Okay. Okay. The test of time for the Zions.
And a good guide position.
Yeah. Okay. So this is the 3028. We take care of that LPL and then we go ahead. I know we have only,
it's
what,
okay. Have
10 minutes more. How much time we still have?
Yeah, about seven and a half minutes. You're good. You're fast.
Okay.
Okay. Get us the LED strength. What do you want? Length?
You're 38? Fine.
38?
35, 38.
That's too long. Eh?
33. 325.
No,
okay. 325.
All right. The art of negotiation.
Yeah. Good.
The guy needs to be a bit more coactive, perhaps.
Which will do? Ready? Take a picture. Sine. Good. Floro.
There you go.
I can tell you that still, Maurice, what you pointed out, having a two wire is the first guideliner, in my opinion, poor man's guideliner. Always should try the two wires first, unless it's a very torturous situation.
Yep, I agree totally. And it's always good for the poor man, as you said, like we are.
The poor man is a guideliner. And also safer.
Yeah, exactly. That Fayez brings a good point. I mean, you say guideliner. Yeah, we say guideliner, but sometimes you see dissections. It's because you're forcing a counter with too much force. So if you can get away with the elegant and simpler way, it's probably better, like you just did.
So far,
and look
beautiful.
At it. Beautiful result.
Yep.
And I do these angulated for the audience. I do these angulated ones. The second wire goes even before I have any issues. There's no need to force. Second wire, then go.
Plus, second wire always follows the first wire.
Yeah.
Always.
It's much easier to cross the second wire than the first wire.
Yep. It goes parallel to it. So it's a nice habit to do. It doesn't cost much, and it makes the procedure easier.
I want it there, but if this doesn't go, you may need the double wire.
Okay. All right. Now, let's see. Take up strength, length, and so for the LED. Yeah, I think the 3.2533 will be okay.
Yep.
Good. Go. Which are we? That's the disease in the mid segment. Yeah.
Wait 1 second.
We have 10 minutes. We have to put them.
Yeah, 5 more minutes.
Yeah.
Take your time. You're doing good. Yeah.
4 is the 4-0, then 4-0-18.
So we got 5 minutes. At 1 minute left, so you don't get cut off, I will let you know.
Yeah.
But so far, excellent demonstration. You know, the basics perfectly covered.
Take the other wire out.
Plus, you know, having hemodynamic support there, it makes you more comfortable. You can do a complete revascularization. You don't worry about the chest pain, ST depression, higher LVDP. I think it keeps that.
2 millimeter more.
Good you brought it up, because we were talking about being cost conscious. And here's the Impella that is. But it's worth the.
It's worth it.
Yeah.
What kind of wire do you have any LID at this point?
It's a
run-through.
Run-through.
A run-through.
I have a few there.
Okay.
Guys, we know that.
Pretty close.
No. That's
fine. Yeah, you're there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Good. And yeah. Even if you're not, sometimes all these little edges, if you
up.
Have
yeah.
to cover it, it's easier after you've post-dilated. Yeah.
Exactly.
Exactly.
And I really, while we are still finishing, the most important thing I forgot to mention to Dr. Waxman and the CRT team, giving us the chances. Year after year, and showing the cases of Impella with atherectomy. And we actually have done 2 times orbital and 3 times rotational atherectomy in the, but all cases in last 5 years have been with the Impella assist.
Excellent. We cannot afford Impella.
And then we'll go to the RO portal for 4.
That's a really good point, though. We had our reimbursement people get up to date on it. I think education of the coders is a pretty important
excellent.
Process at your shop. We thought we couldn't afford it either until we got them up to speed.
Now, actually, let me tell you another trick about the Impella. If for some reason, which we never do, if some reason now you leave the Impella in the patient after post-PCI and you remove it next day, there is a new DRG code, which is almost double the reimbursement than your original procedure. So it's like 135,000.
Yeah.
Now, how I can tell you that how our American government is that foolish, that's a separate story.
You're on camera. Be careful.
You're very close to DC, so.
Yeah. And we have the Attorney
be
General.
Be careful what you say.
We have the Attorney General next door. Holder is literally next door. Ex-Attorney General.
Good. But key, the consistent data has really helped to get this, I would say, Impella in the mainstream, and similar kind of case here. Let's say we'll take a picture to see that we are covering the proximal part. Good.
Cranial.
To cover the ostium, you need to go to the cranial view.
I think two things. People saw it used in cases and thought, geez, this really helps. But also, the company did make it simpler. The console got a whole lot easier.
No doubt.
The cath lab people.
No doubt. They did a great job at simplification, at teaching. It's even I can set it up, so that's just a big deal.
There you go. There you go. Red to red, yellow to yellow. It's okay.
A regular view.
Be careful from protruding too much in the aorta,
exactly.
Because you're going to need to come. You more than likely would need to come back at some point. So don't make it hard on yourself.
Bring the guide in. Yeah, good.
Okay, yeah.
Pull back.
I would not protrude too much.
Yeah.
Remember.
Because this case. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, good.
Ready?
Looking good.
Good.
60
good.
Seconds.
Yeah, you have 1 minute remaining, and if we get cut off.
Good.
Thank you.
We want to thank you both for this excellent demonstration. We learned a lot.
The ostium looks good.
Yeah. Don't go too far.
Yeah.
We went in a little bit.
Good. Okay.
Yeah, don't.
A little bit. This is a 4-0, 18 Zions Alpine, 16 atmosphere.
Good.
It will require a little post dilatation in that area. 4.5.
All right, so 30 more seconds.
Yep. And we just want to take one picture.
Yeah, take one picture, please. And from the panel, myself, we'd like to thank you for hanging with us and the audience as well.
All right.
Looking
great
good.
Great job.
I mean.
Thank you.
I think excellent demonstration of, you know, protected PCI, which is really the protective trial that
support
device and give us much better initial.